Bruce DuMont back. We continue with hour number two of Beyond the Beltway, and Patrick Hanley joins us in studio along with Christopher Nywing. And joining us now from the great state of Ohio, Karen Kassler joins us. She is the Ohio Bureau Chief. She's based in Columbus, Ohio, and she works for both the public television and public radio and has been doing it for quite some time. Gary Abernathy knows the state backward and forward. He writes Abernathy Road. He's a columnist for the Washington Post, whose column appears in a variety of newspapers all over the country, including many leading newspapers in the state of Ohio. Folks, all the Sunday morning shows, they all did a big rollout today on what's happening in Ohio. So I guess some of the big news may be out, but I want to ask for a little background. Obviously, we're going to talk about the endorsement of by Donald Trump of J.D. Vance. But prior to that, and I want to get everybody's reaction, we'll start with you, Karen. What was the general impression of what the U.S. Senate primary race was going to be all about this year?
Well, there are seven candidates in this race, and it's really unusual, obviously, to have an open U.S. Senate seat. And when Rob Portman decided to retire, that really opened up the field. On the Democratic side, there's three candidates running. On the Republican side, there had been eight, and then there were seven after Bernie Moreno, a Cleveland tech guru and entrepreneur, had decided to step out of that race. And so with seven candidates, two of whom are really long shots, have no real chance. You have five leading candidates, all with a lot of money, all willing to self-fund. That really opened it up. And none of them were necessarily really very, very well known. They all had some name recognition, but none were hugely well known. And so there was an opportunity for any one of them to break through. You had Josh Mandel, former state treasurer, who's run against Sherrod Brown before running into the race. He was the first in there. Then the former Ohio Republican Party chair, Jane Timken, who had been hand-selected by Donald Trump to head the Ohio Republican Party, she joined in. Then Mike Gibbons, a Cleveland businessman. Then you had State Senator Matt Dolan. You also have J.D. Vance in here. And so it really creates a wide open field that even with a Trump endorsement, I'm not sure we know exactly who's going to win this race.
Mm-hmm. Gary, your assessment of the same field and any projection you'd like to make?
Yeah. No, I agree with Karen. Picking a winner is pretty foolish when you have that many candidates, especially, I think, five leading candidates who are going to divide that vote up. The endorsement, no doubt, gave J.D. Vance a big boost. He wasn't doing particularly well until that endorsement came along, which is why a lot of people are kind of baffled at the endorsement. Mm-hmm. You know, I wrote a piece last week saying, if anything could people always ask, what would it take for Trump's base to finally abandon him or desert him? Well, this won't do that. But for the first time, I've heard a lot of Trump supporters in Ohio shaking their head and saying, why did he endorse J.D. Vance of all these people? Because Jane Timken, Mike Gibbons, Josh Mandel, all very pro-Trump, you know, all out trying to outdo each other to be the pro-Trump candidate, and didn't have the record of saying those you know, bad things about Trump that J.D. said back in 2016 and 17, and yet Trump endorses him. But Bruce, it was funny today, just recently, I think Trump's campaigning in Nebraska, and he was holding a rally, and he actually, Karen, you're nodding, you've heard this, he actually said, he was bragging about his endorsements, and he said, and in Ohio, I've endorsed J.D. J.D. Mandel. I've endorsed J.D. Mandel, and he's doing very well. So I tweeted out, I said, Mandel's going to have a tough time resisting not turning that into a quick campaign ad on his own.
Well, according to one of the polls that was released this morning, if you would compare March to now in the state, J.D. Vance went from 11% to 23% following the Trump endorsement, and Mandel was at 20, and he's dropped to 18, and Gibbons has gone from 22 to 13. That seems to be the big drop there.
I think that was a Vance. I think that was a Vance poll put out by the Vance campaign. Not saying it's wrong. Sometimes they put out good polls, but you can't entirely trust a poll put out by the campaign.
Sure.
But there's no doubt, Bruce, that it gave him a big jump, a big boost.
What's his connection? Everybody knows about, in fact, this was something else on Meet the Press today. Helene Cooper of the New York Times was talking about J.D. Vance and how everybody loved J.D. Vance, and they wrote the book and they loved the book. And then she was confused. She says, but I don't know how someone who could write a book like that could sort of think the way he thinks now. I mean, she couldn't believe the transition. Is anybody buying this transition, Karen? Because of the candidates, Republican candidates, there are more things on paper that J.D. Vance said against Donald Trump than anybody else. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, that's what the people who have raised real concerns about J.D. Vance's endorsement by Trump have been bringing up over and over, some of the things that Vance said. And some of these are retreads from when he first jumped into the campaign, yeah, because some of that stuff really came out right as he launched his campaign. But then, yeah, when that coveted endorsement came out, because everybody had been vying for that, except for maybe Matt Dolan, the state senator, who said he would take it if it were offered, but he was the one that Trump had actually weighed in on, saying he would not endorse Matt Dolan because his family owns the Cleveland Guardians, and Trump was opposed to the change of the team from the Indians to the Guardians. But I think one thing it's really important to remember here is it isn't necessarily just that Trump likes J.D. Vance. I mean, clearly, with what Gary just brought up, I'm not sure how well Trump even knows J.D. Vance. But there's a lot of connections there between J.D. Vance and Peter Thiel, the Silicon Valley investor, and also he's a huge investor in Donald Trump and the MAGA movement. And also there's a big connection between J.D. Vance and the folks at Fox, who still have a fair amount of influence on Trump. And I think that those two things really kind of explain a little bit more about why Donald Trump backed J.D. Vance over the other candidates who had been in the race longer and seemed to really be coming up with the Trump line more ferociously.
Gary, when you are analyzing this race as the votes come in on Tuesday, you're going to be looking at the entire Buckeye State. Give us a little geographic thumbnail sketch, if you can, of what will be the biggest region for Vance, and where will Mandel be the biggest?
Well, in Ohio, and I'm anxious to hear Karen's analysis on this too, but in Ohio, we tend to divide the state between north and south, you know, above Columbus and below Columbus. Mm-hmm. And below Columbus, or as they say in Ohio, below I-71, is more Republican territory. And even during the Trump, you know, Trump tended to bring out, eastern Ohio used to be more Democratic, kind of that Appalachian region that, mm-hmm. that J.D. Vance kind of writes about, Kentucky, that whole Kentucky Appalachian region. But they really, you know, went strong for Trump in both 16 and 20. So the general election, the theory is always, you know, Republicans want to suppress the northern vote, Cleveland and the more Democratic mm-hmm. vote, and Republican and Democrats want to suppress, you know, the southern vote, and whoever can suppress each other's votes more win. But in a primary, it's not that simple. I mean, you've got four candidates at least all trying to be the pro-Trump candidate. And as Karen pointed out, Dolan is not really the anti-Trump candidate, but he's just kind of, he's not, Dolan's main sin, as far as Republicans are concerned, is he's willing to admit Joe Biden won the election.
Okay, we've got to pause, Gary. In the upcoming primary on Tuesday in Ohio, we have been talking about where the Trump supporters might be going in a very crowded Republican field. But I'm wondering, Karen, I'm going to ask you this question, what impact it might have even on the Democratic primary for the U.S. Senate. There is a primary. It doesn't have the visibility, but it does involve Tim Ryan, who has been a moderate to conservative Democrat. Some people will say that, you know, there's a lot of Trump people that like Tim Ryan. So my question, will this have potentially any impact on the Democratic primary, because some conservative moderate voters who might go for him are going to stick in the Republican primary?
Well, I think that, yeah, I think you're absolutely right about the assessment of Tim Ryan as being a conservative to a moderate Democrat. And I don't think there's really a whole lot of competition. He does have a contender from his left, a Columbus-based activist named Morgan Harper, who has run against, she ran against Congresswoman Joyce Beatty before and didn't score very highly. But I think it's pretty clear that Tim Ryan is probably going to win that race. He's better funded and better known. He's also from an area of the state that has gradually gotten more and more red. I mean, Northeast Ohio, Gary was absolutely right that the I-70 is pretty much the dividing line sometimes between North and South.
I said 71. Right, thank you.
That's all right. But there's huge swaths of Appalachian Ohio, which used to be fairly blue, and they have gradually turned more and more red. And the area around Youngstown, which is where Tim Ryan's from, is a classic example of that. Mm-hmm. There's some other areas around Toledo, up on the west side of Cleveland. Those are kind of the areas. But we're also seeing the bluing of certain cities. I mean, Cincinnati, Southwest Ohio used to be very red, and now the Cincinnati area itself has gotten pretty blue, which is interesting when you start looking at the way the congressional map has been divided up in Ohio. And that's a whole different topic, though, that we still have an overwhelming percentage of Republicans that are representing Ohio in Congress. It really doesn't match the percentage that people vote in Ohio, Republican versus Democrat. But certainly the cities are pretty blue. It's those other areas of the state, the suburbs, that have gotten bluer over time, but still maintain some redness that I think we're going to be looking at. And this is a state that Trump won by 8 points in 2016 and 2020. So the conventional wisdom is whoever wins the Republican primary for Senate is going to be the one who becomes Ohio's next senator. And that's why $65 million has been spent on ads in this race already.
Well, regular listeners to this program know that this program has been on the air well over 25 years in the Youngstown area, and we're now on in western Pennsylvania, and I have said every basically year, if you drew a 200-mile radius around Youngstown, Ohio, including western Pennsylvania, you're probably going to decide who the next president of the United States is going to be. And I guess my question is it safe, Gary, would you say that it's safe to say that Ohio is going to be a red state? It's going to continue to end up supporting a Republican for president in 2024?
I think it's not quite the swing state it used to be. It used to be the nation's bellwether state. As Ohio went, so went the nation. But I think that I'm not ready to write it off entirely as a swing state, to the possibility that it could return to that. I think Trump is a unique phenomenon in Ohio, and I'm not sure any other Republican candidate brings out the type of diehard voter that Trump brings out for himself, and which has carried over to other elections. But, you know, the census numbers tell us Ohio has become an older state. Yeah. That trends Republican, usually more conservative. So, if I was involved in the Democratic Party, I sure wouldn't. I wouldn't be riding off Ohio.
We've got a question from Patrick Hanley, who's our Democrat back here in Chicago. Go ahead, Pat.
Thanks, Bruce. So, Gary and Karen, kind of following up on that last point that you made, the way that I think about elections these days, especially after Donald Trump, is that the coin of the realm is authenticity. And Donald Trump has that. But the front runners for Senate on the Republican side perhaps don't. I mean, Josh Mandel, J.D. Vance, both have the whiff of hypocrisy around them. What they've been doing and saying for the last 10 years doesn't exactly align with what they're doing and saying now to get votes. But Tim Ryan doesn't have that. Tim Ryan seems like the kind of guy who's been doing the politics he's been doing his whole career. Do you think there's anything to that kind of authenticity, hypocrisy approach that might help Democrats in November?
I think that there's something to what you're saying. In fact, on the campaign trail this weekend, you have J.D. Vance campaigning with Congressmembers Marjorie Taylor Greene and Matt Gaetz. And Taylor Greene even brought up that word authenticity and saying that she didn't see it in Josh Mandel. And Matt Gaetz made a comment about how Josh Mandel seemed like he was, I think, reading a script by Jim Jordan, but it didn't make any, I can't remember the exact analogy he used, but it was still playing on that whole question of authenticity. And yet they're campaigning with a guy who some Republicans are saying has very little authenticity because of the things he said at the beginning when he first launched, before he launched his campaign. Tim Ryan is really interesting because I think he's following the Sherrod Brown playbook. U.S. Senator Sherrod Brown, arguably the most popular Democrat in Ohio, and really speaks to that working class, blue collar, Democratic voter. And Tim Ryan is sounding an awful lot like him. I just did a preview on the Republican and Democratic U.S. Senate primaries. And it was interesting to compare Tim Ryan to what I've heard Republicans say over the last couple of years and how Ryan is really walking that line of the moderate, which is not necessarily what you do in a primary typically. You typically go for the far right or the far left because those are the people who turn out to vote. So I think it'll be interesting to watch him campaign against whoever the Republican candidate is and have that question of authenticity, who seems like they really believe this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I agree with all that. Although I think the authenticity is going to matter a lot more in November. Mm-hmm. I think that in the Republican primary, you know, the base is still right there to they're listening for who's the most pro-Trump, frankly. I mean, in Ohio, Republicans are still Trump. They're still Trump's people. And so that's why.
Is there an issue? Is there an issue they talk about, Gary? Is there an issue they talk about? Is it inflation? Is it the border? Is it foreign policy? I mean,
the border, immigration, who can outdo each other being tough on immigration and the culture war stuff. You know, they like mm-hmm. to hit a lot on the things like the so-called Don't Say Gay bill in Florida. Mm-hmm. And, what's the critical race theory? They're all going to keep critical race theory out of the schools. Mm-hmm. I don't think any of it's gotten into the schools yet, but they're all going to make sure to keep that out.
By golly, so, yes, we've kept it out.
those are kind of the hot button issues.
Yeah. One other obviously big race is you have a race for governor. I mean, about a year ago, most people would say that your incumbent governor was going to be safe. But again, there's a number of other people that want to take his job away. He is 75 mm-hmm. years old. He is Mike DeWine. He is a living legend in the state of Ohio. I believe that he's been elected to every statewide office you could possibly get elected to. A unique candidate in a variety of ways. There's a possible scandal that might be brewing about him, Gary, that involving energy and energy.
Well,
funding,
yeah, I mean
funding.
That kind of happens. That's kind of out there, Bruce. Is mm-hmm. that, there are people. The former Speaker of the Ohio House has been Larry Householder has been charged with crimes related to bribery and so on in the First Energy deals. What you're talking about,
yeah.
DeWine, I don't think has been connected to it in a deeply involved way, except for the fact that he signed the bill into law. But I don't think he's been accused of what others have been accused of, which is basically taking money to make it happen. But in the primary, you know, DeWine would be in trouble if there weren't two opponents who are kind of splitting the vote.
Yeah.
There was a DeWine. A lot of conservatives didn't like how DeWine handled the COVID pandemic over the first couple of years it happened with a lot of he kind of led the nation in being tough with lockdowns and so on, and
he was a media darling.
You have a couple of candidates, and according to polls, the ones I've seen, Karen may have others, DeWine's only polling about 43% of the vote, which would get him beat if he only had one opponent, but he's got two opponents who are kind of evenly splitting the anti-DeWine vote.
But Trump hasn't weighed in on this, even though he supported Jim Renucci a couple of years ago. He hasn't given the kiss on the cheek to Renucci yet. Karen?
Go ahead, Karen.
Yeah, there actually are three candidates in this race,
right,
besides DeWine. One is kind of running this stealth campaign. We haven't heard anything about him. He filed, and that's all we've heard about from him. But he's in the same vein as these other two. Jim Renacci, the former congressman from mm-hmm. Northeast Ohio, who ran for U.S. Senate against Sherrod Brown in 2018 and lost by about 6 points. And then also Joe Blystone, who is a Columbus area farmer and business owner. But their whole campaigns have really been about the cultural issues, the social issues, and opposing DeWine on the COVID things that he did, that they really felt that he had gone too far in terms of shutting down businesses and schools and that sort of thing. Of course, a lot of that is over. I mean, We're not wearing masks in Ohio. Schools have been in session for over a year. So I'm not sure how much these issues still play in people's minds. And the big thing, of course, with this race is the money. I mean, DeWine is the best funded candidate for re-election as governor in Ohio history, most likely. And so
75 years old. He's 75 years. Is he still got spring in his step? At 75?
He sure seems like it. He seems, I mean, I cover him. My job at the State House News Bureau is to cover the state officials, and he hasn't seemed to have lost a step at all. He's out and about all the time. I think, though, you asked about the scandal. There are two things that are potentially causing some issues that Democrats will be able to maybe keep, seize on coming up this fall.
Hang on just a second, Karen. We've got a break here. When we come back, I'm going to let you give those 2 points and let Gary weigh in as well. And we're talking about Ohio politics. 1-800-723-8289. If you've got questions for the Buckeye State, now's the time to call. Back to you. Bruce DuMont back, and we're going to let each of our guests in Ohio take a moment to introduce themselves. And Gary, give us a little 30-second background on your distinguished career. Go ahead.
Well, thank you for calling it distinguished. That's always a matter of opinion for other people to decide. But I've had a career divided in both journalism and politics. I started out in newspapers, worked for three or four newspapers around Ohio, smaller community newspapers, and went to work then in politics for a congressman named Frank Kermes, who was a one-term congressman in Ohio, worked at the Ohio Republican Party, then went to West Virginia for a few years and worked in politics, Republican politics there. And this was before Republicans ruled everything, so it was a lot more fun and more challenging. Came back to Ohio, actually worked for Senator Voinovich and then Senator Portman for his first 9 months in the Senate, and had an opportunity to go back into journalism, and went back to my hometown, the Hillsborough Times-Gazette, where I was the editor. And in 2016, we were one of only six or seven newspapers in the country to endorse Donald Trump for president, which got some people's attention. And frankly,
got your phone calls returned.
For me to then write for the Post and do a lot of other things on a national level that that hadn't come my way before, frankly. Mm-hmm.
Karen Kessler, tell us a little bit about your career around the Capitol in Columbus.
Well, I'm a lifelong Ohioan. I worked in Columbus after I graduated from Otterbein College, and then I moved up to, I went to grad school at Ohio State University, then moved up to Cleveland and worked at a news talk radio station in Cleveland, and absolutely loved Cleveland for 8 years. Been back here in Columbus for 18 years covering politics at the building behind me, if you can see on the podcast, the Ohio State House. And it's been quite a difference over the last 18 years, how things have really changed.
I want to go back to just a couple of follow-ups with DeWine. Would you say that DeWine has reached the level of Taft in the state of Ohio, or is he still not quite at that level with Republican hierarchy historically, Gary?
You know, that's a good question, and maybe some more time needs to go by to see how someone lands in the annals of history, so to speak. I've known Mike DeWine, Governor DeWine, for a long, long time. You know, good man. I'm probably a little more conservative than he. I'm probably among those that wasn't real thrilled, frankly, with how he handled COVID, and I wrote about it, so that's no secret to anyone. But I don't know. You know, the Taft legacy involves kind of a family legacy. It's not just one person. So I don't know. I'm interested to hear what Karen thinks about that, because you're right, Bruce. Mike DeWine's held, you know, so many different offices. He's become part of the landscape in Ohio.
Over 40 years as an elected official. Karen, quick follow-up on any comparison you'd want to make with the Taft family.
Yeah, one of the first big situations that I covered when I came down from Cleveland working commercial radio and came to public radio and television in Columbus was Bob Taft and his time in office. He's been well known over years and has the family legacy of the Taft name. He also became the first Ohio governor to ever be charged with anything in office. He was charged with a misdemeanor for a campaign violation, which was quite a stunning thing when it happened. But DeWine definitely has that family name and legacy. I mean, for many, many years, the only person who ever seems to have ever been able to beat him was Sherrod Brown. And in 2006, when Brown unseated DeWine in the U.S. Senate. But I think, you know, DeWine's name is very, very well known. I think his popularity is still pretty high. I think there are Democrats and Republicans who are frustrated with him with what happened with COVID. But I don't think there's any chance that he loses this primary just because of what he brings into this with his name recognition and the money.
Well, also, I mentioned earlier that he was regarded as a media darling because he was viewed as one of the more progressive media favorites, the way he was handling COVID. So I'm sure that riled up a lot of conservatives when the Washington Post and the New York Times start singing your praises. It doesn't help you in the precincts.
Well, I could speak to a little bit of that because DeWine was one of the first governors to actually go on TV and radio and do press conferences during the whole COVID shutdowns. And as part of my job in public broadcasting, I partnered with our version of C-SPAN, the Ohio Channel, to bring those broadcasts to Ohio. And so for, I think there were 57 total broadcasts every single day where he was updating people on what was going on with COVID. It became known as Wine with DeWine because it was always at 2 o'clock every day and people would take that break, get a glass of wine and walk away from the kids for a little while or something. But of course, it started to become monotonous, and then it started to become concerning when people were having trouble with their businesses and their livelihoods, and there was learning loss for the kids. All this, it obviously became very serious over
time. By the way,
time.
We should mention, by the way, that...
Could I add one thing on that too, Bruce?
Sure.
Those televised conferences he was doing every day, he was doing them with his health director at the time named Amy Acton. They both kind of became these, you know, Wine with DeWine celebrities, and memes were created with DeWine and Dr., you know, Amy Acton. Mm-hmm. But it really took a toll on Amy Acton. And part of the criticism of DeWine is he had her out front and center so much every day after day after day that as the tide began to turn against what was happening with the lockdowns and so on, she kind of was the one taking the brunt of that. And I'm not sure it was entirely fair to her. And she frankly ended up, I think safe to say, resigning because of some of the heat that was coming her way over it. And, people marching in her neighborhood, protesting her.
By the way, we should mention that Mike DeWine is running for re-election. He is running in a Republican primary. And again, it is contested, but he's got maybe a comfortable lead at the moment, according to some internal reports. But again, there is a Democratic primary. The former governor of Cincinnati and the former governor of Dayton, Ohio, they used to be friends, but they're running against each other. So, Karen, tell us a little bit about, I'll have you talk about the mayor of Dayton, who also got some national coverage because of the horrible shooting in her city last year.
And I will say one more thing about Mike DeWine in that his popularity still has been pretty high, even though there are some polls that suggest he isn't going above 50%. His popularity has still remained fairly high along with others, other Republican governors throughout the pandemic. But on the Democratic side, I think that is the more interesting primary because you do have two mayors, mayor of Cincinnati, mayor of Dayton, former mayor of Cincinnati, John Cranley, former mayor of Dayton, Ann Whaley, who, like you just said, used to be friends, probably still are once this is over, I have no idea. But they've kind of gone back and forth a little bit over some of the specific plans. I mean, for instance, the former mayor of Cincinnati, John Cranley, wants to legalize marijuana. He wants to use that money to fund broadband and infrastructure jobs. He wants to create an energy dividend for people making under $75,000 a year. Got some very specific ideas, whereas Nan Whaley's ideas are a little bit more wider reaching. She's talking about universal pre-kindergarten and things like that. So they've had some pushback occasionally in debates and other settings, but for the most part, it's been a really civil an issue-driven campaign, which is kind of a contrast to what we've seen on the Republican Senate side, which has been a lot more about who's Trumpier and where the social issues are and those sorts of things.
Yeah. By the way, we should mention that the primary is coming up this Tuesday, May 3rd, and it is Ohio. That's going to be where all the network focus is. Indiana has very little activity going on this coming Tuesday. The following week on the 10th, it will be Nebraska and West Virginia. The following week on the 17th, it'll be a big night. Idaho, Kentucky, North Carolina, Oregon, and the big one in the east will be Pennsylvania, which is also has a hotly contested race for the U.S. Senate there. And then at the end of the month, Alabama, yeah. Arkansas, Georgia, which, again, probably is going to make the most news this month. And then the Texas runoff, because they did not get to over 50% there. So the month of May will be a busy month. And again, a reminder,
yeah.
on the first Sunday of each month, we're going to be talking about the major races coming up that week. Gary
and Bruce, if one more thing on the
sure.
primary, I'm sorry. This and Karen may weigh in on this too, because of redistricting controversies and court actions. The primary, Ohio's primary is being split this year. So what's happening Tuesday is state legislative races are not going to be on the ballot, and it's going to be interesting to see how that affects, if at all, the federal races. Will it affect turnout very much?
Uh-huh.
I've talked to people who think there'll be a pretty really low turnout on Tuesday, despite all the attention that we've had to this race, in part because of people aren't really sure what's going on with the primaries. And it's been in the news a lot. They know that one primary got moved and over split off, which will be held later in the year. Mm-hmm. So that's another factor to consider when we look at what happens on Tuesday.
Well, the National Press is going to be looking at what happens in the Senate primary, determining whether or not J.D. Vance was helped by Donald Trump or not. But let me ask, what's been the relationship of Donald Trump and Mike DeWine? Because he hasn't endorsed anybody against DeWine, but he hasn't endorsed, you know, DeWine either, Karen.
Yeah, and I had heard that there might be an endorsement in that race, but it never came. I mean, Trump was in Delaware County, which is just north of Columbus. It's a county that used to be super red and now is trending a little bit pinker over time, or purple or whatever.
Uh-huh.
Getting a little bit more blue, I guess is what I'm saying, but not nearly blue like you would expect a city would be. But he still had a lot of support from a couple thousand people who showed up there, even though there is still these questions about whether J.D. Vance is the candidate that some Republicans think that he should have endorsed.
Uh-huh.
But Jim Renacci, I think, is the real interesting story there, because like we said before, Renacci ran in 2018 against Sherrod Brown. He claimed that Trump had asked him to get out of the governor's race in 2018 and run against Sherrod Brown. And he did that because Trump asked him to.
Yeah.
And so I think he was hoping for that Trump endorsement that does not seem to have come. And
hoping
so
for the endorsement.
I think that Trump has been a little critical of DeWine, but, you know, certainly he hasn't spoken out to the point where.
Oh, I can only imagine what the political folks are going to be talking about on next Wednesday morning, figuring out what happened in Ohio, and no, he didn't really win, and J.D. Vance. Well, I guess one of the big pieces of news, and I think it would be a legitimate piece of news, is if J.D. Vance lost.
Yeah.
If J.D. Vance lost, that's a big loss for Donald Trump.
Sure.
I think.
Yeah. High risk, high return move. Right. So he picks somebody and who if J.D. wins, Trump gets to claim credibly that he changed the race and J.D. owes him a big one. And so does Peter Thiel.
OK.
But if he loses, then, yeah, that's a chink in the armor.
Gary, do you agree with that? That I mean, literally, it will be a big national story if J.D. Vance loses. I mean, the big thing is they will take that and they will tie Trump around him. And that will set the die for the rest of at least the rest of the month.
I absolutely agree with that. And, you know, same with, you know, the other races where he's endorsed, same with Dr. Oz, right? And,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, so he's, you know, Trump, a lot of people claimed Trump was kind of averse to risk a while back when he was endorsed. He just wanted to endorse sure things and people who were going to win. he's kind of proven that to be wrong. He's really gone out on a limb with some of these endorsements, particularly J.D. Vance, or as he called him today, J.P. Mandel, but particularly with J.D. Vance, because he was not leading the polls when Trump endorsed.
Right.
According to different polls, he may have been in third place. Big news if Vance loses.
And it's a roll of the dice with Dr. Oz. Now, Dr. Oz is the celebrity candidate, and I guess you could say that J.D. Vance is sort of the celebrity candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But again, if Dr. Oz slips, and everything that I have read does not indicate that Trump is going to do well in the Georgia race for governor. And I don't think he's going to knock off governor, in Alabama, Kate Ivey. So, I mean, he's got possible three or four big losses. Do you think he could withstand, could, at what point does he no longer get identified as a potential kingmaker? It's when his people start to lose, right, Karen? He's got three or four big losses in 1 month.
Yeah, when I was talking to a national GOP consultant today who's based in Ohio, and he was saying that whether it's Vance or Mandel that wins in the Ohio primary, the real winner is Donald Trump, because it was Donald Trump's race. Everybody, save for Senator Matt Dolan, essentially, was vying for the Trump endorsement. And so all of Trump's issues, all of Trump's talking points were front and center. And so that's an interesting way to look at it. But yeah, if Vance doesn't do well, if Oz doesn't do well, if Brian Kemp does well in Georgia and not David Perdue, if the Trump candidates don't do well, then yeah, that really does suggest that there's a problem here. One of the things that Trump did do in Ohio that makes it very safe is he endorsed 9 of Ohio's 12 Republican congressman. Mm. Now, he was not going to endorse Anthony Gonzalez, who's the Republican congressman from Northeast Ohio who voted for Trump's impeachment, but he's not running for re-election. But he has endorsed 9 sitting congressmen and endorsed one of his former advisors, Max Miller, who's running for Congress, all of whom are likely to win election re-election. So those are safe bets that he's made there.
Do you think, Gary, I'll let you tackle this one first. Do you think the voters of Ohio, the primary voters of Ohio, the Republican primary voters of Ohio, do you think that they grasp the power that is in their hands to basically begin to put nails in the political coffin of Donald Trump by their vote?
I do. I think they do grasp it entirely, and that's probably to Vance's advantage, because I think a lot of people who really don't want to vote for J.D. Vance, they know that if Vance doesn't win, it hurts their guy Trump, who they love.
Yep.
And if they don't push Vance over the finish line, as much as they may not like Vance, trust him, believe that he's had a change of heart that he insists on, then the national narrative is going to be, by the media that they consider anti-Trump anyway, is going to be, oh, look, Trump's lost his mojo. And so I think a lot of Republican voters factor that in, Bruce, when they go to the poll and go, I really like Mandel better, or I like Timken, or I like Gibbons or Dolan, but I'm going to vote for Vance so that Trump has a victory here. That'll be how a lot of them think.
Karen, do you agree with that?
I think it's a really interesting thing to look at it that way. I know that after the Vance endorsement, there were some Tea Party groups and others that really pushed back. They came out. I mean, even like Christian groups who said that this was not the right endorsement. They urged people to try to reach out to Trump and to not vote for Vance. But whether people will actually take that to heart and do that is I think, a really interesting question. I will say that the J.D. Mandel endorsement line that Trump put out there today in Nebraska is already being picked up by Mike Gibbons. And Gibbons, Vance, and Mandel have all been kind of jockeying for that lead position in, or at least what we think is the lead position in the polls. And I think that it's interesting that Gibbons is already seizing on that with some news releases that are coming out to reporters tonight.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, people will be watching what you folks have to say. What will be the first sign that it's a good night for J.D. Vance? I want to get that from either of you, because, again, the national news media is going to be extrapolating here, okay, where Vance is strong, they think that Trump is going to be strong, and they're writing their Wednesday morning lead.
Yeah. I think, you know, I think a high turnout is probably good for Vance. I think a high turnout means Trump people are coming out. A low turnout's probably not. But it all depends on Ohio has been kind of Karen can speak to this, too. Ohio's been a little unpredictable in how they release their results the last couple of elections. You might get, you know, you might get 10 counties done, and then you're waiting an hour and a half for 10 more counties to come in. So it's very hard to read early results. So what you have to kind of look at is turnout, and then you hear exit polling, and you hear what these people do in the exit polls tell you. But I think the turnout... High turnout's good for Vance, low turnout's not.
Okay. We're out of time on that particular point. Gary, thank you very much. Karen Kessler, thank you very much. You're going to be busy, folks, in the next 48 hours. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts here this evening. Also to Christopher Newayne and also Patrick Hanley for joining us. I'm Bruce DuMont. Good night from Chicago.